Hello and welcome to The Wire Explains, our daily show where we talk about recent events. We're doing things a little differently today. We're going to focus on the Northeast. I'm Jahnavi Sen from The Wire, and this is Sangeeta, Barooah, Pisharoty. The two things we're going to discuss today, first is the CM change that's happened in Nagaland and the rebellion that took place within the Naga People's Front. And the second thing is the blockade that the Indigenous People's Front of Tripura organized, and that was 10 days long and it was called off yesterday, and what that means and whether that really means the issues they were fighting for are sorted. So let's start with the CM change in Nagaland. Yeah, so can you tell us what exactly happened that led to this? Just a brief recap on the events before the change.
See, this is basically a kind of a power struggle that between the chief minister who's been sworn in today, Tia Zeliang, and the NPF president, who was actually brought in as a kind of an to quell the kind of a rebellion against Zeliang and Sudhohole Lizitsu, and that was in February. And so now that the whole political the problems in the state, the violence that led to Zeliang's decision to hold the urban local bodies elections with 33% reservation for women, that was not acceptable by the to the tribal organizations. So they demanded that Zeliang should step down, and then Sudhohole was brought in, and a kind of an emergency arrangement, and then Zeliang of course wanted the seat back, you know. Apparently we are getting to hear that there was some kind of a tacit understanding between the two that he would go to step down. But what problem began after he as per the constitutional demand, he had to get himself elected, because in a way he had taken retirement on the political life, you see. And so when his son stepped down from the assembly, he resigned from the assembly seat, that's when the other members got to know about this side of the he's not going to resign. So it set the alarm bells, and that is where the entire problem began. And so then, as it has happened before, when these NPF rebellion happens, they often rush to resort in Kasiranga. It become a butt of all jokes. So that happened, and then it came back, and apparently the governor helped Zeliang, and so that is what we are getting to hear. And so he staked claim, and there was a bit of unpolitical uncertainty that went on, and today he became the chief minister again. But the issue here, Jahnavi, is that a lot of in coming times, it will be a very interesting thing for the constitutional experts and journalists who take interest in these kind of subjects to look into a lot of things that had happened in Nagaland, in the last few days after this whole the demand for chief minister change. So that was like the people are questioning the governor's role. Then there was a court case, and then also the speaker's role. The chief minister who stepped down today, or he has not stepped down actually. He has not tendered his resignation to he has not submitted his resignation to the governor. And then we see another chief minister being sworn in. I don't think it has happened anywhere before. And the other thing is like as chief minister. As chief minister is being sworn in, who's actually being expelled by his own party. So which party or does he, which entity, political entity does he represent? I mean, is he an independent? We don't even know. And the interesting thing is, like in the morning, the assembly secretariat issued a notification saying that Zeliang is the NPF, the legislative party chief whip. But that chief whip is announced by the president of a party, which is like the man he's trying to unseat. So, and the Sudhohole, he last night itself, he named somebody else as the chief whip, and also issued a whip. The party issued a whip to all the MLAs saying that you are not supposed to vote for him. But today when we see that 47 of the 59 MLAs have voted for Zeliang, so does that mean they will face expulsion or suspension of the party or any kind of punitive action under the 10th schedule? Where does it fit in? So that's what I'm saying. In coming times, you will get to see, I hope so, that you get to see these kind of questions being raised, because these are interesting questions. When we saw that in Arunachal, you know, and suddenly a kind of an assembly session that happened in a resort, in a community hall. So it happened. And then the Supreme Court took a lot of time, but gave a very interesting judgment. So what is it? I mean, what is it going to... come to? So these are questions we will find some of the answers I hope in coming times.
But another interesting thing you mentioned about the chief minister's change that happened in February, one of the plans was that this was just instability, but that's not what we're seeing happening. Do you think that's likely to change with this, or you think this sort of turmoil is going to continue for a while?
My understanding is that it's not going to bring in any stability, because it is already a wobbly government. I mean, we don't know which party does it belong to. The chief minister has been sworn in by the governor, and who's apparently won the floor test on whose behalf. Are they all independents now? So we need to... So I don't think, you know, it's going to happen. And also what we heard from the political observers and senior journalists when I spoke to some of them last few days. And so what I got to know was that on the day Zeliang was called by the governor for the swearing in, and he said, he wrote back a letter saying that you swear me in only today, only me as the chief minister, and I'm going to name their people later. So that is also going to be an issue. I mean, how many are going to be accommodated in his new ministry? And there's also a concept of parliamentary secretary to appease everybody. So everybody is somebody, you know. So all those things. So if that doesn't happen, you know, so what's going to be the situation? Because why I'm raising this is not for the first time that this has happened. You know, this is the third time we're seeing this kind of political upheaval. So you can actually imagine what must be the state of administration of that state, you know. I mean, this also, so there is a lot of public frustration in the whole thing, you know, and the state is going for elections in early 2018. So we'll get to see a lot of, you know, the effect of that in coming times.
Yeah, Nagaland is definitely going to be a state to watch in the coming days. And so let's move on to the blockade in Tripura. It was called on the 10th of July and called off yesterday by the Indigenous People's Front of Tripura. They've called it off, but there was a rail and road blockade. They've called it off now. But do you think that their demands they will be met? I mean, have they got what they wanted out of it? Or
see, as far as my understanding of it is concerned, and according to my sources, what I got to know is that this blockade, the lifting of blockade, is only for about 48 hours. It is not, yeah. So, and also on a condition that the delegation of IPFT, the Indigenous People's Front of Tripura, have been camping in Delhi, wanting to meet the Home Minister, Rajnath Singh, and it's just the meetings have not happened. And then apparently the Home Minister, the Minister of State for Home, Kiran Rijuju, he had put in a kind of a, these are all media reports, that he has put in a kind of a condition that you have to lift the blockade for the talks to begin. And so that is, I think, is the understanding. And in coming week, in this coming Monday, Tuesday, so they are likely to have a meeting with Mr. Rijuju. So a lot will depend on that. And this is another state which is going to the polls in 2018. And also a state where we've been seeing a lot of rumblings, political rumblings. That's happening. Yeah.
Because that may not be as up to date. Could you just give us a brief recap on why the blockade happened, what they were asking for?
Okay. So see, this is a very old issue. Okay, this is the demand for a separate state, a state of Tripura land. So, and basically, there is an autonomous council which we call it TTAADC, which is Tribal Areas Autonomous District Council, and which covers about two-thirds area of Tripura, and we're about over 12 lakh people, mostly tribals, whom they call Borok Lok. So they live there. And so the demand of IPFT is that turn that area, that area, into a separate state. And which the ruling party, which is CPIM, and the BJP, the opposition, Congress, TMC, all the other parties, including and then Indigenous Nationalist Party of Tripura, that are all opposed to this demand. Okay, because they say that this is not a practical demand, and Tripura is a small state. Yeah. But the IPFT base is that. Is actually for that you need to go back to the partition, you know, because this is a state which shares border with what was East Pakistan, and now it's Bangladesh. So, and then 1947, when this division happened, so a lot of Hindu Bengalis, they moved from that area into various parts of Northeast and mostly into Tripura. So, and then, of course, then the Bangladesh war happened in 1971, and there was a kind of an influx even then. So, and that what happened was, I mean, it affected hugely the population of caused a lot of demographic kind of a change there. You know, in 1941, there were only 53% of tribals in Tripura. And now when we see the 2011 census, it says it has come down to 30%. So the indigenous people have become 30%, while the migrants have become 70%. And the migrants have begun to control the political space, the socio-cultural space, you know, language and everything. So that has led to a lot of these kind of, you know, kind of confrontation, and very ugly confrontation where a lot of people have died, and also led to the birth of insurgency in Tripura. And because since it's a border area touching Chittagong, and then apparently, according to media reports, that there were days to the militants were operating from Chittagong side, and which I think the army and the Bangladesh government did a kind of an operation reportedly. And so that led to the kind of the peace came in. And that's the reason that 2015, you saw that APSPA being lifted. It's the only state in Northeast, thank God for it, so it has been lifted. So, but now the thing is, now we see this old problem coming again. Yeah. So, and I see that it has, it is linked to the coming elections.
You said that Rajnath Singh had this condition, and so now that the condition has been fulfilled, has there been any news of whether these talks will take place, when they'll happen, and what do you think these talks could mean politically for the parties in the state?
Not Rajnath Singh. It is Kiran Rijuju who is going to represent him. That's what he said, that I've been asked by Mr. Singh to meet this delegation. And this also happened because Manik Sarkar, the chief minister, and he apparently called up Rajnath Singh and asked him to meet the delegation so that this issue, this entire blockade, and then lifted. Because see, the blockade is terrible for the state, because they were blocking NH8, National Highway 8, which is the only link of the state to the rest of India, I mean through Assam. And the other thing is the railway line, which is the only railway line which is also linked to Delhi and the other states. So one way, yes, completely, one blockade can actually stop all movement, completely slow down your life. And that was the reason I thought Rajnath Singh was called. And then he but then it's also kind of, you know, a kind of a sword hanging over your head, you know. I mean, like, either you agree or we don't lift the blockade. So I think that's the reason the central government said that for a conversation to happen, you need to do this, you know. And also a lot of common people were suffering. So thankfully, the IPFT leaders understood that. But I feel that it's not going to remain like this if something doesn't come out, because it's also a political party, remember. So there will be some kind of political backlash going to happen, certainly. Yes, so that's what I see.
It'll also be interesting to watch those talks and see where those go. That's all we have for
the next speak, it's coming. The coming week, the meeting's going to happen. So let's see if something comes out.
Okay, thank you for watching, and please join us again next week.